two of the horror guys. And
extra hand you got there?
Yeah.
Or did you lose yours?
Always need an extra hand.
That's true.
So
know when it comes in handy.
I gotta hand that one to you. Guys, this is the horror guys. I'm Kevin, John, you know. And today, being the spooky season, we've decided to cover our 31 Days of Halloween movies.
And this is cool because we did a similar thing last year where me and Alan went head-to-head, and we're doing the same thing. You have your list. I have my list of 31. You did show me your list, but I can obviously sit here and tell you that I do not remember what was on it.
Good.
I took forever to make mine because I'm an indecisive bastard when it comes to movies. I tried to change it up and put some stuff on there that I feel doesn't get enough notoriety. So yeah, we're going to go head-to-head. You're going to see our picks. They're going to pop up on the screen. And we're going to just head off here with we're starting at number one, right?
Right.
Okay.
Or 31.
Well,
we're starting at 31.
Makes sense. Counting down to number one.
To our number one pick.
All right. So, you know what? Should we flip a coin? Should we make it official to see who goes first?
Flip a bottle cap.
We're flipping a bottle cap.
All right.
So, I mean, it does make sense because we're drinking beer.
Heads.
Tails. Heads is Bud Light. Tails is not Bud Light.
Call it in the air.
All right. Tails.
You're up first.
All right. So, my list is all over the place, but starting out, number one, my number 31, I guess, sorry, number 31 is going to be Terror Train. You ever seen Terror Train?
I have not.
Okay, so Terror Train is a movie that was a very young Jamie Lee Curtis was in. Happened after Halloween.
Of course, obviously. Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah, I mean, come on. There's got to be some kind of, there's a theme here with me, you know? Also features David Koffer. That, David, what the fuck? I can't talk today.
David?
Try that again. Thank you. David Copperfield, the magician.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's in it too. Very cool movie, though. Takes place mainly on a train, hence Terror Train. But there is a mass killer, which is kind of cool, as he changes his appearance throughout the movie, which is really cool. And the ending, I'm not going to give away the ending because we just talked about doing a show where we do shocking endings, and I think that might be part of it. Because
cool.
This was a cool-ass 3-for-a-loop kind of ending,
yeah.
Which I really enjoyed. But if you haven't seen Terror Train, it's the 80s, horror film.
That's fair.
Good time. All right, hit me with number 31.
My number 31, Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho.
I mean, a great movie.
Right. And again, we've talked about this movie before. Alfred Hitchcock is just a genius when it comes to his filmography.
I agree.
Cinematography,
yes.
Whatever you want to call it. I like the concept of how you never actually see anybody die in this movie.
Yeah.
But it's still, it creeps on you. I mean, it's one of those ones that like you're tense through. I'd say 90% of the movie.
That shower scene,
yeah,
is something that you
which
remember.
We talked about.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you will not ever forget that scene.
Nope.
If you're in the shower, it will pop in your head that oh shit.
Yep.
Mama Bates might come get me. You never know. It's kind of creepy, man.
No, you're 100% right, and it's and I love the concept of you don't know about his mom.
No.
For a good portion of the movie.
Yeah.
And then you find out, you know, there's this dead lady.
Yep.
In the bedroom.
I mean,
and
you know, this kind of crazy.
Yeah.
He's
been dressing up as her, and yeah.
I mean, to me, that's some stuff that can happen in real life.
Right.
It probably has happened in real life, let's be honest. There's some sick people out there.
And honestly, that movie could have been higher up on my list.
Yeah. I mean,
but we've talked about it before, so I didn't want to put it up higher and recover it.
And to be honest with you, I'm jumping around too because we kind of changed our format a little bit. We didn't really know our format going in, we'll be honest with you. So we kind of changed it around, jumping through the list here to see what happens. Good first choice, though. I like that one. And I need you to check out Terror Train, though, seriously. To me, it's one of those movies that doesn't get enough, I don't know, man. Nobody talks about it. Yeah, nobody really talks about it, man. It's like, it's such a cool movie.
Agreed.
And again, like I said, Jamie Lee Curtis started out in horror. Young, Halloween, Terror Train. Not Psycho, Prom Night. You know,
yes.
She started out in her early horror movies, you know, and she kind of disappeared for a while, did something else. But yeah. So we're going head to head as Terror Train versus Psycho. We both went in that one.
Yeah.
And you guys went too because there's four movies. All right, man. You're up first. Go ahead. Let's hit number 30.
Me next. Let's go with The Ring.
Okay.
Now, I have on my list The Ring, but I do want to say I prefer Ringu.
The original, absolutely.
It is definitely creepier.
Mm-hmm.
I watched both of them. I watched actually back to back when I first watched them. I waited for them to come on DVD. Didn't see it in the theater. And it's one of those things that like Japanese culture, with horror especially, is really, really messed up. Like, there's, you know, you got The Ring, you got The Grudge. I watched one, I want to say it was called Hair, where...
These are very vengeful, spirited women.
Yeah. Like, but, I mean, and that's their culture, though, yeah. Is that, like, if somebody dies painfully, violently, whatever,
right.
They're a violent ghost, and they're going to get your ass.
Yes.
So...
Some creepy shit, man.
Yeah. In 7 days, you will die.
Yeah, hey, listen, I'm not watching shit, and then, hey, what am I going to do within that 7 days? You know you're about to die. What do you do?
Try to figure out how not to die. Like,
that makes sense too. All right, you picked The Ring. I'm gonna go with Freaks from 1932.
Oh, that's a good one.
That, I forgot all about that movie. Some people may not be considered a upright horror movie.
But it's not scary through the majority of the movie.
No, and it's not. I think the scariest thing about it, it's actually sitting right here.
Freaks Revenge.
Cool VHS version of Freaks. But from 1932, you have Todd Browning's The Freaks, obviously. And the thing about this movie is, back in this time, they were using real, as they considered them, freaks in these movies. So the pinheads,
yeah.
And the conjoined twins. And
they actually remade this movie, and I don't want to, they might not have called it Freaks.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
But yeah. It was basically the same exact movie, mm-hmm. And they did the same thing. Yeah. They used freaks, and I don't want to call them freaks, but like, I mean, that's the name of the movie.
Do you remember... Do you remember when ICP was in WWE for a while?
God, yeah.
And they had the oddities?
Yes.
Do you remember this little guy was in the video for the oddities, dancing on the table?
I did not.
Yeah,
that was part of check that out.
They clipped it out. That was part of their video. So they used this from Freaks. I don't know if that's a public domain thing now that it's so old.
Maybe.
But no, that was one of the coolest scenes of the movie, though, where they're trying to get the girl to, who's straight up a normal woman, try to become, you know, part of them. She would be one of them, you know, and then she, like, freaks out. And she's right. She's not a freak. You know,
right.
That basically sets them on a path where we knew she was a bitch from the start.
Yep.
And we're gonna kill her now.
And I guarantee you that American Horror Story Freak Show.
Oh yeah.
Definitely watch stuff like this.
You would have to
pull a lot from it because I mean there are similar concepts in that TV series as in this movie.
Now for fun, and hopefully we won't get flagged for it. I will somehow find that clip and we'll throw it in there somewhere where they do the little scene where he's dancing on the table, which is actually really cool. That's
hopefully it is free domain.
Right. The whole ceremony where, you know, she's going to be one of them. So yeah, cool ass movie if you haven't seen it. It is in black and white. And the ending's pretty cool too, which is kinda on the cover, so if you can see that. Oops. But still, good time either way. So yeah, it's The Ring versus Freaks.
I'm gonna have to give this one to Freaks because that was a sleeper one I forgot.
Both good movies though.
Yeah.
Both good movies, man. I mean, and that's the thing. Like, Freaks isn't one I've talked about a lot on here either, so it's kind of cool to have that in your list. All right.
We'll make her one of us, a loving cup. We accept her one of us.
Gooba gobble, gooba gobble.
We accept her.
Gooba gobble.
One of us.
They're going to make you one of them, my dear.
So am I up on this one?
Yep, 29.
Oh boy, number 29. Let's see here. All right, I'm going to go back to a fun one. Dolls.
Okay.
Do you remember Dolls?
I remember toys.
Remember toys. Okay, so, all right, dolls. We have, this was a Full Moon movie. So, Full Moon is like one of my favorites out there, Trauma and stuff like that. So, Full Moon's like, you know, Puppet Master and all those, and all the crazy movies like that. So, Dolls is more or less you have this man and his wife and his little girl, and they're driving on the, you know, it's raining, it's dark, it's one of those dreary nights, you know. And as they say in this movie, it's the longest night of the year or something like that, you know. So, this little girl has a very vivid imagination of her teddy bear coming to life and rips her dad apart and stuff. It's pretty cool, you know. Like,
because
the dad is kind of, he's a dick, but the stepmom's even worse. Like, okay. She's a complete bitch. They end up at this house, and he's very, very, very old couple who have this, like, huge mansion house and all this stuff. And they look like they'd be creepy as shit. And then, like, another group of people show up at the house, and they all end up staying at this house overnight. And needless to say, the guy is a doll maker, and his toys come to life. And, it's a cool-ass movie, a lot of fun. Like I said, it's Full Moon, so it's that not really kind of Puppet Master-esque vibe to it. But very cool movie. I always liked it. If you haven't seen it, you got to check it out.
I'm definitely going to have to look at that. All right, so mine, I'm going to go with the Twilight Zone movie.
Oh,
now, I've talked about how much I love the Twilight Zone
on
past episodes here.
Yes.
And I love the original black and white, which, don't get me wrong, the new ones are good.
Right.
But nothing will ever beat Rod Serling.
Not at all.
And the Twilight Zone movie, if you haven't seen it, is they take, it's three, I believe.
Three or four stories.
I believe it's three. Because they've got,
the story with the racist guy.
The what?
The story with the racist guy.
Yeah, the racist guy, the thing on the plane.
Which, he died in that movie. It was him, and I think the one, was it a kid? I think that died too in that?
I don't remember.
When they were doing the scene in, like,
you think
the,
I should remember
swamp.
This?
Like, the helicopter actually crashed into that, and they died during that scene.
Yeah.
It was crazy, man.
But you got that, you got the thing on the plane.
Yes.
Which
was an old William Shatner
episode
on the original Twilight
Zone. Which, the thing on the plane was a much more creepy looking than a Bigfoot looking gorilla guy.
I will say that John Lithgow played the hell out of that part.
He did.
He really did.
And the one with the little boy, and I can't remember the name of that one, but where the little boy can make things happen with his mind.
Oh, yeah. That was a good one, too.
The part of that scared me the most when I first watched it, because I was younger when I watched it, was when they walk past his sister's room, and he says, she doesn't talk much.
Oh, yeah.
And it pans to her face, and she has no mouth because she talked too much, she yelled at him too much, and he made her mouth disappear.
That was a cool-ass segment. I enjoyed that one.
Yeah.
Okay, let me ask you this, though. Out of the stories and the one, was that your favorite one?
No, out of everything, my favorite was with, you want to see something really scary?
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't even the movie. It was Dan Aykroyd
and Albert Brooks.
Brooks. Driving in an ambulance, taking a patient to the hospital.
Oh, that was the ending. Yeah, that was your wraparound.
That was the beginning and the ending.
Yeah.
Because the beginning, they talked about how have you ever seen those Twilight Zone movies? Those were, or TV shows, those were creepy.
They were going around in the car singing Midnight Special, and the tape messed up in the tape player.
Yep.
And then they started talking. Yeah.
So at the end, he's like, you want to see something really scary? And his face is all demented. Yep.
And then turns around, and the wraparound will say, because it's an anthology, so you got your wraparound. There he is, the ambulance driver now with John Lithgow in the back.
Yep.
Hey, you want to see something really scary? And then you know what's coming. No, that's a cool ass movie. Mm-hmm. I'm surprised I didn't put it on mine, because that is a fun ass movie.
That is, again, all these probably could move higher on my list, but because I have so many, I don't want to move them up higher.
Right.
No, so that's my 29.
All right.
Which one do you think?
I got to go with Twilight Zone the movie, man, because, I mean, I love Dolls, don't get me wrong. Twilight Zone the movie, just you saw the enjoyment when I was talking about that, but, like, I love that movie.
Yep.
All right, am I up on this one, or are you up?
I'm up.
This is yours,
I'm going to go with Pulse.
All right.
I've seen Pulse.
Yes, I have. It's been a long time.
So, the main thing I'm going to talk about with Pulse is, when I was younger, this scared me a lot. This isn't the one that scared me the most, but this movie scared me a lot. And the reason that it scared me, and it was a shower scene. Do you remember the girl's in the shower? The house decides to turn up the heat.
Mm-hmm.
She starts getting burned on the back and everything. And it's one of those glass doors with the metal handle. So she grabs the handle. It burns her hand. She can't get out of the shower. Guy has to come in. He breaks the shower with a lamp. Saves her from being burned alive. So the concept of the movie is basically the house is killing them, trying to kill them, doesn't want them there, wants them out. So, that movie scared me so much as a kid that for probably about a good month, every time anybody would be in the shower at my house, even though we didn't have those sliding doors, it was just a curtain. Anytime somebody was in the shower at the house, I sat outside the bathroom door waiting for that water to turn off so I knew they were okay.
That's freaky, dude.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna,
as a kid, it traumatized me.
All right, so you hit us with Pulse. I'm going to say, now this is a new one. I just recently saw this one, and I normally don't, I'm not going to say that new movies aren't good, but they don't have the lasting impression as the older movies from the 80s and the 90s. And, well, shit, Freaks from 1932. So
right.
It doesn't have that lasting impression. But this one was cool. That's why I'm going to put it so early on, because I don't think it really... I'm not going to say it won't stand the test of time. I'd probably watch it again, which I will. But it's called Haunt.
Okay.
All right, so here's the thing. Got a group of people who want to find a haunted house. So they do, and they're just driving randomly, and boom, a sign just lights up out of nowhere. It says haunted house. That tells you something, right?
Yeah.
Probably don't want to go there, but that's how movies start.
So that's going to do something stupid.
Right. Oh, look, a sign just out of the blue lit up and said haunted house. Don't go there. So they do end up going there because they're stupid. And the first thing they see is this clown. And it's just a very old, like, what was that material they made those masks out of back in the day that you couldn't breathe wearing them?
Oh, the latex stuff? The
costumes would come with, like, that
terrible piece of suit. That plastic.
Yeah, like that plastic shit. They were wearing, like, those style masks. So he was a clown. And he was just, he wouldn't speak. He handed them these waiver, or he handed her a key, which she had to open the thing, which then had waivers and put your phone in and all this shit. So you read this waiver where it tells you that you can't touch them, you can't do this, they're going to ask you to do certain things, you have to do them. And you basically signed your life away.
Yeah.
So, of course, they all sign the waivers, and they go into the haunted house, and things get... It's kind of a slow burn, not a terrible slow burn. Haunted house itself is kind of boring, but when they walk through spider webs, there was real spiders in it. That freaked me out because I don't like spiders. They had to go into a coffin at one point, but they had to realize that when you shut the coffin door, that's when the other door opened for you to pass through. So they had to go in one at a time and go through this damn coffin. But anyway, you get to a point where they show this one of the friends is like tied up and stuff, and she gets a poker through her head, and you think, was that real? Was it part of the show? They don't really know yet. Long story short, they have a scene in there where there's a guy with a devil mask, same thing, that old school style mask, and he takes it off, and when he takes it off, it's that, that body modification shit.
Yeah.
So the guy's got, like, actual horns and lumps under his skin to look like a devil, and it was creepy as shit. Like, I was like, wait a minute. The clown takes his mask off, he's got the damn clown smile on his face, to actually look like he's morphed into a clown. I was like, dude, this is kind of cool, right? So there's one dude in the house that takes his mask off at one point, and, like, you know, I didn't do anything. They told me if I killed someone, I would earn my face. So as you're killing people in this place, you're earning that face you get. It's pretty fucking cool, though.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, that's a different concept. Right? Had a cool ending to it, which I won't give away because I know you haven't seen it.
Yeah, I'm definitely checking this one out.
But, dude, it was a fun-ass movie. Like, like I said, I don't normally put new shit on my list.
Yeah.
But this was cool, man. I really liked the concept of it. A lot different from, like, House of October, though, which wasn't a bad movie. I just thought the ending was...
Yeah.
But other than that, I think this one was better than Hellfest.
Okay.
To me, because Hellfest had all the right things, just wasn't, I think, played out right. But I think Haunt was definitely a cool one, so I know you got your list to watch for this month if you get a chance.
Yeah, I'll throw that on there. I have my backup movies to watch, too, so that'll be thrown on a backup.
Is it mine or yours?
Your turn.
Oh,
number 27.
Okay. Wow. It just gets harder and harder, man.
Yeah.
Because there's so many good ones.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Let's see. This is getting tough. What do I want to go with? I'm sitting here looking at this list and I don't want to. Okay. I'm going to go with my favorite in the franchise.
Okay.
Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3. Dream Warriors. I love that one. Okay, I love the original Nightmare on Elm Street. I think it's a creepy-ass movie. I think the second one was trying too hard to be scary, but it wasn't.
Okay.
But part three, to me, this is when Freddy kind of got a little silly, but do you not remember the iconic line of, welcome to primetime, bitch?
Yes.
That right there says it all. I love Halloween. I love Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3. Always been my favorite of the series. So that's got to be on my list.
All right.
Absolutely.
I'm going to go head-to-head with you with Wes Craven's New Nightmare.
Oh, so we've got a dueling Freddy here. Yeah. Okay.
So right. This is the first Freddy movie I ever saw.
Okay.
And I saw it at a drive-in.
Nice.
Which was a double feature. The first movie was Birdcage. So, yeah, weird combination, right?
Did you guys get Birdcage?
Birdcage.
New Nightmare.
Movie about gay people.
I'll tell you what. I have a similar story to that. Okay. I remember seeing a double feature at a drive-in. Was Colors. Remember the movie Colors?
Yeah.
And Friday the 13th Part 6, I believe it was.
Okay.
So there's our. I think you take the cake on Birdcage and
Freddy. Yeah, that's a weirder combination, I think.
Yeah.
But.
Hadn't it been Birdcage and Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2 would have been one of the same.
Yeah.
A lot of gay tendencies in that movie, no offense, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
A lot.
Nothing wrong with the gay community.
Not at all. I'm just saying, if you've seen Part 2, there's a lot.
But yes, yeah. It's just the same similar concept of Freddy Krueger, except that now he's in the real world. Going after the actors who played in the movies, not going after characters.
Which is something you didn't really see a lot in movies.
It's something a little bit different. They tried to make it look like this was really happening, like Wes Craven even is just Wes Craven in the movie and everything. It's cool.
Robert Englund was Robert Englund.
Robert Englund played Robert Englund, but he also played Freddy.
Right.
The only reason that I picked this one over any other one is it was the first Freddy experience for me.
And that's cool, though. Yeah. I mean, that had a lasting impression.
Yeah.
Like we said about some of these other movies, that the newer ones really don't, the older ones do.
Yep.
You know? All right, I dig that, man.
So, which one you got?
All right, so I'm up here, and let's see.
I'm going to aim with, who do you have winning?
Oh, who do I have winning?
Yeah.
I got to be partial to Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3.
That's fine.
If I combine, if I'm taking the two movies, I don't dislike New Nightmare. I just got to go with Part 3. Welcome to Primetime.
Freddy and Freddy.
Yeah, Freddy versus Freddy.
It's hard. I mean, in that case.
I mean, right here we got Freddy versus Jason. Right here we got Freddy versus Freddy.
Yeah.
Just saying, man. Right,
so it's my turn?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to go with People Under the Stairs.
Oh, I love that.
Which we have right
here. Yes, it is up here. Just People Under the Stairs. I dropped the bone. But
that's all right. You boner. People Under the Stairs is just one of those. It's considered a horror comedy.
Yeah.
The family has a daughter.
Yes.
They love the daughter. Everybody else in the house lives under the stairs and gets treated like shit.
Yeah.
You
find out some real messed up shit about that family.
Yeah,
you
do.
Not that people living under the stairs isn't messed up.
Yeah.
There's more to it, though.
But little boy basically is trying to save the girl from the house.
Yes.
There's a guy under the stairs that can get into the walls and get around and everything. And at first you think he's bad, but then it ends up he's actually good. The girl likes him and he tries to help them.
Yes.
You know, the family locks the little boy in the house and they got to figure out how to get out.
Let's just say he runs into a not so fun house, but
in
a sense, that's pretty much what it is. It's a damn fun house.
It's a nut house.
Yeah, that's for sure. That is for sure. And the lady that plays in that movie that plays the, we're going to call her the mom for now. To me, when she starts crying and shit, she looks like Julia Roberts. A whacked out Julia Roberts. Because she had that big ass lip.
I'm going to have to rewatch this and
she does. Check her out. Especially that scene where she got the figure shoved up her nose. She looks like Julia Roberts, I'm telling you, man. I thought for a while when I was younger that was Julia Roberts, but it wasn't. And the dude that plays in there, and why can I not think his name? Everett McGill. He who played... And you know what I'm going to do? Since you picked that one, I'm going to put this one against you because it actually stars Everett McGill also. You ready for this one?
Yep.
I got you on this one, man. I don't got you on this one, but I'm going to throw it at you. Silver Bullet.
Okay.
That is one of my all-time favorite werewolf movies.
Stephen King.
Yes, sir.
Yep.
And Everett McGill, who plays in People Under the Stairs, plays the priest in Silver Bullet. If you haven't seen it, do we want to give it away? Really, it's an older movie.
It's an older werewolf movie.
Yeah.
I agree, it's better done werewolf movie than most.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You get, Werewolf in London, Werewolf in London, American Werewolf in Paris.
Yes.
What was the...
We don't talk about American Werewolf in Paris in that movie, but...
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Oh, wait, let me take that off my... No, I'm kidding.
Oh.
I'm very disappointed with werewolf movies. Because I feel like they never make the werewolves look good.
There's very few.
Man. Underworld did all right with how they look. The transformation.
See, now I wish we had him here when we did the werewolf segment because we did the show on that and we had some good ones, man. And there's some bad ones too.
Yeah, there's a lot of bad ones. I mean, like I said, I didn't say all of them, but a lot of them just don't make the werewolves look
good. 100%.
I mean, I prefer Wolfman, the original Wolfman, over the majority of
Wolfman from Monster Squad was better looking than some of the shit I've seen now. Like, he had nerds.
Just watch that, by the way.
Wolfman's got nerds, by the way. That's a valuable lesson learned from that movie.
Just saying. Wolfman's got nerds.
Now, I won't go on a big tangent of Silver Bullet, because we did cover it on the werewolf episode, but a couple key scenes in that movie, obviously, was when they were in the church, and the guy was, you know, the priest himself was having the dream, and everyone in the church ended up turning into werewolves, and then the one playing the organ was, like, the best part of that, but that was a creepy-ass scene, though. And long story short, if you have seen it, then you already know that Everett McGill ends up being the priest in the movie, ends up being the werewolf. So you got Corey Haim, who's out shooting fireworks one night, and a wolf tries to attack. He ends up shooting a big-ass bottle rocket into his eye, and then he tells his sister the story, who does not believe him. And then she ends up going around trying to help the kid out, because he's in a wheelchair, so he can't do it himself. So she goes out trying to, you know, collect bottles from the town, and she finds out that Father, whatever the hell his name is, I don't remember his name right now, Father Wolf, ends up having a patch over his eye, and so guess what? Her brother may have a little truth to his story. But he ends up being the werewolf. And the other scene that I like, too, is when the cop goes to talk to him, and he's looking through the garage, and he's all the cans and shit from all, like, the can drive and all that, but he finds the bat, the guy's bat in the bar. And then that's when the priest comes in, and, you know, and they finally, like, he starts to transform. And ends up fucking up the cop, too, which is a really cool scene. But, yeah, man, Silver Bullet versus, I have to look again, People Under the Stairs. I got to go with you, man. I love People Under the Stairs.
I was going to go with you because Stephen King's hard to beat.
It is, but it was cool that we had something that kind of went together.
Yeah.
The same guy playing pretty much a main character in both movies.
Yep.
So, yeah, I got to go with you on People Under the Stairs, man.
Sounds good.
It's been one of my favorites for years. So. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back. We're going to knock out some more because we had a lot more.
Yeah, we still got 25 more to go.
And harder. So we'll be right back.